Ladies and gentlemen, this is the main event of the evening.
For one, Andre.
You're not good at this. Get out. Let me tell you a personal story about Vince McMahon.
You just made the list.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
Sorry, no speak English.
Dummy.
Goodbye and good night. Fall two.
It's still real to me, damn it!
Dummy, yeah.
This is the worst town I've ever been in.
Hole three, the moss covers, three handle, family Bradunzel. Mamma mia!
And now, Unchained.media presents the B. Plus Podcast with your host, Greg Unchained.
It's me, Austin. It was me all along, Austin.
Number four, Armbar.
I will never retire.
I still got 200 more. I got 200 more holes to lift.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the B Plus Podcast. Today is, I don't know when you're listening to this. It's Thursday as I record it, which means this could come out on Friday. It could come out on Saturday. This is a bonus episode anyway. We're going to talk this month in Brit Res for September. So joining me, of course, is Akil the Heel. How are you, Akil?
I don't know why I'm a heel all of a sudden. All I do is speak the truth.
No, because you went heel on Adam Brooks last time around, and for my listener base, you know, being Australian as I am, it's a little bit, you had a bit of a heel turn.
Fair enough.
Yeah, you and Arn both, you're the heel faction within the B Plus.
I think, again, we're just not afraid to tell the truth.
But it's not about fear. It's about personal preference. That's the thing. Everyone likes something different in professional wrestling. And I feel like I disagree with my co-host for Impact a lot as well, with Jay, the regular Jay. I disagree with him a lot as well. And I think it's okay for us to disagree. We like different things. That's all well and good. But let's get into it. We don't have a lot of time, but we want to talk about this month in Brit Res and, you know, a lot of things going on in Britain, which, even though it was a quiet month, there's still a lot of things for us to talk about.
Yeah, there's actually an absurd amount of things when I actually... we've got this little list of stuff to go over, and it's a lot busier than I thought.
Yeah, and then we're adding things, and I'm like, well, we're probably going to have to take that out because of time reasons and stuff. So, like, things like the OTT 4th anniversary, I think we'll probably talk about that next month after it happens. Things like that. WXW World Tag League as well. We'll probably have to put a hold on that. But let's talk. There's some big things happening for Rev Pro. Let's start there.
Yeah. So in our last episode, we talked a little bit about how they had these TV tapings coming up. They've now done the TV tapings. So the actual cards look quite fun. They've got a good mix of the current Britres guys, a lot of older guys who just missed the boom but are still quite good, and some guys who are just coming up now aren't quite that sort of Will Ospreay, Zack Sabre Jr. level of major star, but are maybe a step or two below. They did draw very, very well, but it was shows in the middle of the week, so it was expected to not do... Like, it was a show on a Tuesday and a Wednesday night, so it's not going to do great.
Yeah, it's an odd time to put on a wrestling show.
Yeah, and the other thing is the shows didn't finish until like 11 o'clock at night, which annoyed a lot of people because it's the middle of the week.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Progress do midweek shows sometimes though, right? But I mean, their fans are kind of like a cult, so you can get them to go to anything.
Yes, but also Progress do, when they do midweek shows, they finish at like 8 p.m. most days, most time, and they've only done one or two that I can think of, at least. Of the proper chapter shows, they've only done one or two midweek shows. It's just a dumb time to try and run. The reason
it is, it's odd.
Yeah,
we've got some TV tapings coming up down here in Melbourne for for one of our companies. They're a new company doing it, and they're taping it midweek as well. And it's I'm like, it's such an odd choice to tape midweek.
Yeah, I think what it is because for the production people, they don't want to be working on weekends. They're just a normal company. So obviously they're like, now, if we're going to film something, we're going to do it during the work week. Not realizing that's a bit odd for wrestling.
But I mean, how much of a normal company are you if you're doing, you know, television production? That's not a normal job, is it? I mean, I guess I don't know what I'm talking about. But I feel like that doesn't sound like a normal job to me. Like a normal job is like, I guess they work in an office, don't they? Yeah, I'm talking out my ass here. Yeah, it's a normal job.
It is just a normal job. It's not a wrestling job or any other kind of entertainment. It is.
It's in entertainment. You're in TV. TV is entertainment.
I think it's entertainment adjacent.
Right, because it's not live. Yeah. Fair enough.
Yeah. So,
but for wrestling, it's odd. Yeah.
Yeah, it is. We know the show is now gonna. The show is going to air on Free Sports, and it's starting on October 19th.
Right, October 19th is the announced date. They announced that like just days ago.
Yesterday, if not the day before.
Yeah. I think it was the day before for me because time zones were It's been announced very recently. October 19th, that one starts, and we're actually talking about Rev Pro as part of the wider. On one of my other podcasts, we call it the King of Sports Cast, and we've kind of rolled out to like a King of Sports universe where we're going to talk about New Japan, Rev Pro, Ring of Honor, and CMLL all in that one show. It's a crazy show. We're struggling to keep it under an hour and a half now. But yeah, so we're going to be talking about the Rev Pro TV there just to take a little bit off your plate because there's so much going on in Brit Res. So when those TV shows do roll around, if people want to hear what happened, the place to be is Wednesdays on the B+. We talk about that on the King of Sports Cast. Now, we also had the British J-Cup was just this month.
Yeah, so the same week as these TV tapings, Rev Pro, they called it Rev Pro Week. They ran like 5 shows in 9 days or something absurd.
I think, was it 7 days in... 7 shows in 9 days?
Yeah,
I think.
That's it. 7 shows in 9 days.
That's speaking in my head for some reason, yeah.
7 shows in 9 days. And
it's pretty insane.
Yeah, to make a point, this is a company that normally runs maybe 2 shows a month. So this was quite a big deal for them. They capped off the week with the British J-Cup, which they did for the first time last year. And it was a really cool show. You brought in a lot of New Japan Juniors. It was a one-day tournament. Jushin Thunder Liger won. It was just a blast. You had Matt Riddle, Tomohiro Ishii on that show as well, which obviously was amazing.
Yes, that would be an incredible match.
This year they did it as a 2-night event, but they did it in conjunction with this Wrestling Media Con thing, which was a very weird convention that happened in the UK. It also included...
Yeah, I don't understand why it was Wrestling Media Con. Like, I guess it was like, you know, Dave Meltzer and all them were there, and it was focused around the media guys. But what a weird thing to do, to focus your convention around the C-list stars of an industry. It just seems like a weird... Like, you know, they're going to invite podcasters and stuff. It was a strange concept.
It's bizarre. What it seems... Because I've listened to one or two interviews with the guy behind it. What it seems like to me is he thought, look, there is a real interest in, there are people that really enjoy listening to podcasts. There are people that really enjoy listening to Dave Meltzer. Dave Meltzer's not someone that's come over here. In fact, I think this is the first time he's come over here as a speaking role or something. So he thought, okay, let's try and do this, see how it goes. Impact ran a show as well, which was supposed to be very, very good from what I've heard.
It was a decent show. There were a couple of good matches. If you're watching Impact Weekly and stuff, it's kind of like some of the matches were same-same. Like the Eli Drake, Joe Hendry match was same-same. But the street fight that closed the show with Sami Callihan and Jimmy Havoc was good fun.
Yeah, they normally have good matches. I heard the LAX tag against Johnny and Jody was pretty good as well.
Oh, yes, yes. That's the one when I talked about it on the Impact Zone podcast, that was the one that I said, this is the match that you go out of your way to watch from this show, was that tag match. Yeah, yeah. And the street fight.
Because LAX are an amazing team, and Johnny and Jody.
Oh, it's Johnny and Jody are absolute legends as well.
Yeah, it's ridiculous how good they still are.
Yeah, I talked about it on the Impact Zone podcast. I talked about, like, they're the first guys I knew from the UK, like, back in like 2002, 2003, when I first got into the indies and stuff, I used to pick up the World of Wrestling magazines at my local news agency before I went to school.
Wow.
And yeah, Johnny and Jody were in those all the time. So
yeah, Johnny, Jody, and Doug, who we're going to talk about in more detail later.
Yes.
Sort of.
Yes.
They held up Britwrest when it was in its what we call the dark times.
the dark times. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Anyway, sorry. So back to the British J-Cup. Because it was part of this MediaCon, it didn't draw very, very well. And
yeah,
the atmosphere of the shows was really, really bad. Like, I tried to watch it yesterday, and the crowd is just completely dead. They've got an amazing...
Yeah, atmosphere. I noticed the same thing watching it. And so then what I did was I shifted, and I started watching it while I was editing. So I had it on mute and I was just watching the action, and it became way more enjoyable.
Yeah. See, I can't do that. I think crowd reaction is something really, really important to wrestling. And
yes,
if there's not crowd reaction, then that's a bad match. The aim of a match is to try and get the crowd invested in what you're doing. If the crowd doesn't care, you're not doing a good job. That's a broader conversation, I imagine.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you to an extent, but I do think there are occasions where it can be otherwise, and especially as we move into an era of streaming content. I mean, you could run a wrestling promotion that doesn't put live shows in front of fans. You know what I mean? And so then how would you gauge what a good match is if there's no fans reacting? But you could do it.
I mean, you could do it. I don't think it would be good. I think it would be like trying to put on a play not in front of an audience. I suppose that's a TV show then, isn't it? Huh.
Yeah. Yeah.
I like how every time I come on this show, you make me question what I know about wrestling. There was a conversation like this last time as well, where I just completely had to reevaluate everything.
It's what I do, man. It's what I do. I challenge people's conceptions.
Yeah. But yeah, British Air Cup, I think... Considering it was one of the highlights of the show of RevPro's calendar last year, has been a bit of a failure this year, especially considering...
Yeah, a bit of a disappointment.
Yeah, especially considering you had Flamita over, you had Bandido over, you had LAX had a tag match on one of the shows. You know, you had this amazing talent roster and nothing great came out of it.
Well, I'm about three quarters through night one, and I'll say this. I really enjoyed Bandido and Phantasma. Phantasma went on to win the thing. I know that. And I also really enjoyed Kushida and Chris Ridgway.
Yeah. So,
like, that was a really fun match.
Yeah, so Chris Ridgway, without giving away too many spoilers, because I know you don't like spoilers, Chris Ridgway is heavily featured in RevPro TV. And he's a guy who a friend of mine, Rob Reed, has been talking about as being the next guy to break out for about 3 years now. And a lot of people have been...
Yeah, Ridgeway's one to watch.
Yeah.
Yeah. He had a really good match with Kenno, I believe, in Frontline Puro.
Yes.
Their first show.
We lost Ray's company.
Yeah, which we'll get to that as well. I guess there's one other thing I wanted to talk about with RevPro after we talk about the disappointment that was the BJ Cup. Global Wars has been announced.
Sure, yeah. So Global Wars is RevPro been running a Global Wars weekender for 3 or 4 years now. It's normally two shows, one in their regular London venue of York Hall, and then one in Wolverhampton. It's been cut to one show this year.
One big show.
That's mostly just from what I understand, because of venue issues. They just couldn't find a venue to do it twice.
Yeah, yeah.
I was listening to Andy Corden on the podcast yesterday, where he was saying he's considering trying to make it run live on the RevPro On Demand service.
Oh, that would be interesting.
Yeah, yeah. They've tried running live shows once or twice before. It's been all right, not super successful, but like it worked. We've got a couple matches announced so far. I don't remember them. We've got Mark Davis, Satoshi Kojima, and Tomohiro Ishii, Minoru Suzuki for the RevPro title.
Yeah. Yeah, and David Starr's defending his title against Kushida, the British Cruiserweight title.
Nice.
Yeah.
I'm worried about that match a little bit because Kushida in the UK has a tendency to go longer than he needs to. there was a match last year when Kenny Omega and the Bucks were over. Kushida and Zack Sabre Jr. had like a 40-minute long match which completely deflated the room. So...
yeah,
on paper, that's Kushida's star. Sounds like a really good match, but you can never be completely sure with Kushida in the UK.
Fair enough. It's one to keep an eye on either way. We'll put it that way.
Great show.
Yeah,
almost definitely. It'll be because with Global Wars, normally what ends up happening is because it's two shows, you get a couple filler matches. Hopefully this year,
all
killer, no filler.
That would be good. That would be good. I said the same thing about Destruction, the New Japan shows. They should have made it one show because there was too much filler. But, I understand the need to do that sometimes. But I think one big show is always better than two average shows.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, that's my two cents anyway. Not that anyone asked for it. But that does it for RevPro this month, really. I also wanted to talk about Pro Wrestling Eve. They have a big show coming up this weekend as part of the Time Out 50. Have you seen this?
Yeah, I've heard a little bit about this. They're running actually a couple shows, I believe, this weekend. It's not just the one.
Right. Okay, sure. And it's as part of some weekend for Time Out where they focus on like local arts and entertainment and all that sort of stuff. Time Out being a big magazine, it's kind of like a pap mag, isn't it?
I don't know what a pap mag is.
Like paparazzi, like they put the celebrities on the front cover carrying their babies.
It's more of just a...
Okay, that's what I thought it was.
It's more of just a guide to what to do in London on a given weekend. It's like a
tourist. Oh, okay.
Okay, here's the big conventions going on. Here's the arts festivals, all of this.
Yeah, well, that makes a lot more sense then, because I thought it was like one of those celebrity rag kind of things.
No.
I'm thinking of something else, I guess. Yeah.
No. It's a relatively big magazine. Eve are a company that are always trying to chase the attention of mainstream media, so I'm not surprised something like this has happened.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it fits the narrative, right? Because they're a women's wrestling promotion, and we're all about empowering women in 2018, which is a good thing. I'm not saying this in a cynical way at all. It's a fantastic thing, and I'm a huge fan of women's wrestling. So, get it, girl! Like, take that mainstream attention. Why not?
Yeah, exactly. But to me, they seem a bit cynical about it. I could be completely wrong.
Okay,
One of the matches on this show is Tony Storm versus Mako Satomura, which is probably going to be very, very good. So,
yeah, that sounds like an amazing match.
So I'm willing to deal with the cynicism a little bit because they're giving us cool stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I mean, they have that very Riot Girl, overt, in-your-face feminism, which isn't for everybody, right? And I know a lot of wrestling fans will get turned off by that kind of thing because they get turned off by it when WWE do it, like, up the women kind of thing. I know a lot of wrestling fans get very insecure about that and sort of withdraw into their shells. And it's not necessarily my bag. I'm not a big fan of that either, necessarily. But you can put that to the side when you're seeing matches like, who was it at Wrestle Queendom that just absolutely stole the show for me? It was... Mako Satomura and...
It was Killer Kelly. No, not Killer Kelly. No,
Killer Kelly.
Kaylee Ray, sorry. Not Killer Kelly.
Kaylee Ray, that's right. Yeah, it was Mako Satomura and Kaylee Ray. And as well, I think it was Piper had a match against...
It was Viper against Aja Kong, which like...
Viper had a match against Aja Kong. Yeah, like it was an amazing show top to bottom, but those two matches, like holy crap. Like I enjoyed the hell out of that show, you know? Even though there may be little things, I still think Eve is one that if you're a fan of women's wrestling, you should be watching Pro Wrestling Eve whenever you get the chance. Yeah, of
course. I think Eve is a company where, for me, I keep them a bit at an arm's length because being as entrenched as in the scene as I am, I know a bit more about the inner workings of Eve, which turned me off a little bit. But if you're willing to just ignore all of that and just go, hey, they're putting on cool shows, let's watch cool shows, go for it.
That's what I do, man. I try to ignore all the bullcrap because there's so much politics and bullcrap in all wrestling everywhere, man. Like I get it here too. And I had a huge rant on my Aussie Graps show that came out Friday that was about, you know, shows running against each other when there's really no fucking need to be running against each other when you're in such a small town as we are.
Especially when you're in a scene that's not really the strongest as is.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, our scene is really good and we have some really, really good wrestlers. I'm talking about specifically here in Adelaide in my hometown, but these two shows just running against each other that are bringing in interstate workers and it pissed me off. And I had a rant about that, but that's as close as I ever get to all the politics stuff. I'm like, I stay out of it. I don't care. I just want to watch good wrestling. And Pro Wrestling Eve does good wrestling. So with all that said...
Pro Wrestling Eve does good matches.
Yeah.
It's worth watching if you're a fan of women's wrestling.
Yeah, absolutely.
Ignore my...
absolutely. Ignore Akil the heel. Stop turning heel on us, Akil. We're here to pump up wrestling. No. What we won't pump up, though, what we won't pump up is World of Sport and their dwindling ratings.
Oof.
It's been a bad month for World of Sport.
What an embarrassment the show is.
Yeah.
Honestly.
Yeah, aside from making me feel queasy and like I need to vomit anytime I watch a match, their ratings just are not telling a good story for the company. They're going on tour, though, apparently.
Yeah, so they've got a tour coming up, which makes me think, even though the ratings look really, really bad, ITV are happy with them.
Yeah, that's what it seems like.
Yeah, so they've got a tour coming up in January, February time. Will Ospreay confirmed recently he's part of the tour completely, which I think is interesting because January, February is around New Beginning time.
Yeah.
So I would have imagined he'd be in Japan.
You'd think that would be the priority.
But who knows, maybe New Beginning's later this year or whatever.
Hmm.
But yeah, so one of the tour stops they're running is York Hall in London, which we've talked is a venue we talk about a lot.
Yes.
Quite a big deal venue.
Iconic venue.
Yeah, very iconic. But yeah, the ratings are really... Last episode got like 0.2 million viewers, which is the lowest they've had so far.
Yeah.
It's
like been going down week by week by like 200,000 at a time, just dropping off.
Yeah, it's really, really bad. I think part of the issue is they've changed the time slot like four times now.
Multiple times, yeah.
That's something which gets me really, really worried that maybe they're not happy with it. Because if you're happy with the ratings it's getting... Why would you fudge around with it so much, you know?
Yeah, it could even be that they don't know what they want and they're just putting it in all different places to see what happens and see what takes, but I don't think that's a very good strategy.
Yeah, the last episode aired at like 2:30 in the afternoon. That's ridiculous.
Yeah, that's...
On a Saturday.
That's a bit early. Let's talk about it. Is it a tax write-off? Is that a possibility? Someone's just like, we don't care if this loses money and is terrible because it's a tax write-off.
No, I think what it is it's just a thing that ITV have. It's just a line item on their balance sheet, you know? It's just, okay, this is whatever. We don't really care about it.
Now I'm the cynic.
Yeah. No, I mean, to us, this is a super big deal. Oh my God, World of Sport's back.
Yeah.
For ITV, it might just be, we need something to put in on a Saturday afternoon.
Yeah, true.
Let's do this thing.
That's true. They're not looking at it as wrestling fans, and we are, so it's kind of a different...
Yeah.
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 Now, you mentioned Will Ospreay there, talking about the tour and the odd dates for the tour. Will Ospreay's promotion, or his latest promotion, Frontline Wrestling. Frontline Puro, but I think they've changed it now to Frontline Wrestling.
I think it's Frontline Pro.
Yeah, I've seen a few different things, but either way, Frontline. And they've launched their on-demand service this month, which I found very interesting because I was going to sign up, and then I was like, wait, they've only done two shows. Which, yes. To me, having a monthly... And do they run shows every month?
No. So the point is, Will Ospreay's previous promotion, Lucha Forever, they started running very, very, like a lot of shows very quickly.
Yeah.
And that was one of their big downfalls.
Right.
So what Will Ospreay has said this time is, look, I'm doing this. Because the other issue was Lucha Forever, he was running in partnership with Ryan Smile, one of his friends.
Right.
This one he's gone, look, I'm doing it completely myself. I'm going to run shows between Japan tours.
Yeah.
So I'm completely hands-on.
Yeah.
Obviously, what that means is it's not a monthly show. It's probably going to be every couple of months. And so that on-demand service is completely pointless. I understand why they did it, just because you need some way to put out shows that's not a show-by-show thing. But I don't know why they didn't, I don't know, partner up with Progress or something and go, look, we'll stick our shows on your streaming service.
Yeah, or even, I mean, if the Lucha Forever shows were available as well on it, you know, just because I feel like, you know, paying, even though it is quite cheap, it's only $5 a month, but $5 a month is still, for when it's not monthly shows, if it was monthly shows, you could maybe get around $5 a month, but I don't know, just to me, just to having only two shows, I thought it was a little strange, but then at the same time, I was like, I kind of still want to sign up because it's Will Ospreay, and, like, dude gives me so much entertainment all over the place that I should probably just give him my money anyway, right? So like, I mean, if that's your mindset, if you're the kind of person who just likes to support the people you love, Will Ospreay has launched frontlinepuro.pivotshare.com, so I'll drop a link in the show notes if you want to go get it. The first two shows are good shows. So they're worth watching.
Yeah, I've only seen the first show, but the first show was a hell of a lot of fun.
Yeah.
It was main evented by Kano of Noah against Chris Ridgway.
Yeah, which is a fantastic match. Yeah.
Yeah, you know, great, great match. Second show didn't have any big name imports. It was more of just a standard-ish Brit Rest show with one big difference, and it's something that Lucha Forever did a lot, is one of the things about Will Ospreay is he likes to really try and help the scene.
Yeah.
In any scene that he's in. So he's doing a really good job of pushing the younger guys who don't really get onto a Progress or a Rev Pro, but who need that experience. And so being on a show that's promoted by Will Ospreay is going to get eyes on them.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And he does really good work for the local scenes he's involved in. I mean, he's done wonders for us down here in Australia. Every time he comes, you know, the shows are bigger and he puts on Match of the Year candidates with everyone he works with, and he elevates everyone, and, you know, and he puts them over too. Like, he put over Robbie just a couple months ago. He does fantastic work, and that's why I want to get out and support it anyway. So Frontline Puro, Frontline Wrestling, it's on Pivot Share. We'll drop a link in the show notes. What else did we have on the agenda? We have, this is something I'm not familiar with, IPW UK. But what you've got listed here looks very interesting.
Yeah, so IPW UK, they're a promotion with a lot of history in this scene. They recently changed ownership. And they were supposed to promote a show with a lot of Noah talent on the IPW show. For whatever reason, I don't know the specifics, that show didn't end up happening, but Marufuji came over, Marufuji did come over, sorry, and he had a match with Doug Williams.
Oh, wow.
Which sounds amazing.
Yeah, on paper, and it also sounds incredible.
Yeah, and I didn't know this myself. Doug and Marufuji actually have quite a lot of history in this country. They've had a few matches together.
Yeah. Well, like back in the FWA days, or?
Yeah. After FWA, it was during when Noah was doing a couple tours here, just on their own.
Okay, sure.
And Doug and Marufuji was a match that happened a couple times. And it's an open secret. Doug Williams doesn't have long left. This weekend is probably his last weekend in wrestling.
Right.
So
that's why I was pulling for him. I was pulling for him in that Nick Aldis match, man, because he had a match at Wrestling MediaCon with Nick Aldis to go on to the winner was going to go on and face Cody at the 70th NWA, and I was like, I want to see it. I want to see Doug Williams versus Cody at that show, even though. You know, the Aldis rematch is something we need to get to. I'm like, put that off and let Doug Williams have a go, because Doug Williams is one of my favorite. I love limb manipulation style, catch style wrestling. So Doug Williams is like right up
Doug
there.
Doug is the best in it,
yeah,
basically.
He's incredible.
Yeah. The rest of the show, I don't know much about. I would try and check out the Doug Williams Marufuji match. Maybe stick around for the rest of the show. I haven't seen it. I don't know what's on it. So if it turns out bad, it's not my fault. I'm sorry.
That's all right. We'll just recommend that one match. That's fine. That's fine. And then we also wanted to talk about the Attack show, which is something that got a shout out on Chapter 75. I was watching Progress and Chapter 75, Eddie Dennis had a shout out to that show. He was like, oh, maybe I want to wrestle you there. Maybe I want to wrestle you at all these other places instead of Wembley,
So Attack is a company that was started by Pete Dunne and Mark Andrews.
Isn't it? Don't they do like video game stuff?
That's what got them their most buzz was these press start shows, which was basically just wrestlers dressed up as video game characters having matches.
Yeah.
Last year's press start happened just after the Pete Dunne, Tyler Bay takeover match, and they had a match against each other where they dressed up as each other and had the same match, but Pete Dunne was playing Tyler Bay and Tyler Bay was playing Pete Dunne.
That is amazing. How have I not seen this?
Yeah, it's really cool. So Attack is basically British Chikara. That's the aesthetic they're going
for. Oh, I love it. I love it. I need this in my life. Yeah, go ahead.
So they normally run Bristol and Cardiff in Wales. But it was actually a couple of weeks ago, I think, the show. I don't have the date off the top of my head. About a week ago, I want to say. They ran a show in London in the Dome venue, which is a venue Progress has used a couple of times for their smaller shows. It was a really fun show. It's really cool that Attack, this is a very small little promotion that's run by the wrestlers. It's really cool that they're running in London now. I've got another show coming up in December in that same venue. It's a company worth, there's not a ton to talk about here, but it's a company worth spotlighting because they're doing cool stuff.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah. Well, no, I mean, look, that Pete Dunne, Tyler Bates switcheroo match sounds fantastic. I know that's not from this show, but Attack. Is it just Attack or is it Attack Pro Wrestling?
It's Attack Pro.
Attack Pro, right. Going to have to put that one on the watch list for sure. Do they have any on demand or anything like that?
They've got a Vimeo service where they sell shows show by show.
The show by show. Yeah, see, I'm not a huge fan of the show by show stuff.
Yeah, there is slight talk of maybe there's being a streaming service soon, but this is talk I've heard for about a year now, so don't hold your breath.
Fair enough. And moving on, we get to the big one. The big one that we really wanted to talk about is probably going to take up the bulk of our time here. Progress Hello Wembley. That's coming up this weekend.
Sunday. It's the biggest show Progress are ever going to have ever run so far. It's one of the biggest European shows European indie shows, depending on how you can classify Progress, whether or not you think they're an indie. One of the biggest European indie shows for a very, very long time. It's going to be massive. The draw, we talked about it a little bit last week. I've asked around a little bit. The number I'm hearing is they've drawn about 3,000 people.
Right, so I saw estimates. I saw estimates on a few sites that they were probably looking at 4, but 3 is still a solid number.
Yeah, yeah, maybe 4 is closer, but yeah, around that. To put that in perspective, NXT TakeOver London ran this same venue, and they drew about 10,000. TNA have run that venue a couple times. At their worst, they were drawing about 4,000. And the capacity for the venue is about 12,000.
Right, so that's got to put Progress, even so if they hit the 4,000 mark especially, but even if they're only at 3, it's got to put Progress up there in terms of, like, when you talk about the biggest companies in the world, you kind of have to put Progress on par with your Ring of Honor and whatnot at this point.
For sure, for sure. I think, like I said last week, they've made no bones about the fact that we're not going to be able to sell this out. NXT haven't been able to sell it out. There's no way we're going to be able to sell it out, but we're going to give it a little try. And they've done a respectable number.
Yeah, absolutely.
ICW in Scotland, for their big shows, they draw a little bit more, but ICW is also a company which, I'll say again, don't watch because it's bad. So, like, I don't care what they've drawn.
They just don't really count. They don't count to Akil the heel.
Yeah, they don't count. They don't count. They're a bad company.
I swear there's something. I'm gonna go through, in any spare time that I manage to find, I'm going to find something from ICW that's worthwhile. I'm going to.
No. There is stuff that's worthwhile. The issue is that they very quickly ruin that. There's a couple periods every now and then.
Devitt was in ICW.
Oh, wow. ICW's actually... Yeah, he had like a match or two there. That doesn't count. He's not like an ICW guy.
Grado is.
Yeah, and they ruined Grado. Grado could have been... You don't know the kind of words.
I've pushed buttons here. All right, yeah. Go for it.
Yeah, because... We'll talk about Wembley later. This stuff that Grado is more important.
Yeah, let's do it. Let's talk about Grado. Grado is a joke.
Look,
you know? But it's a good joke. I
Grado
love Grado
at one point. But yeah, but it's look. I've been saying Grado was one of the biggest reasons why the Britmess boom happened. He had that Vice documentary, which made everyone realize, oh wait, there's pro wrestling in the UK. Let's see what's going on. Grado, his feud with Drew McIntyre was really, really good. And Grado was one of the most over babyfaces in the country. I've been saying for a while he could have been a British Dusty Rhodes. He was great. And it's partly ICW's fault. It's partly his own fault that he seems to be happy to just be this comedy guy and not really want to take it further. But he could have been the biggest. He's one of the most important British professional wrestlers of this era, and he could have been as big as anyone.
So you think if played differently, he could potentially be Pete Dunne?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. I know it sounds ridiculous.
It does sound a little ridiculous, to be honest with you. Like I said, I love Grado, but I think he is a comedy. I see him as a comedy guy. And I love comedy wrestling, so I don't look at that as an insult.
Yes.
So.
Yeah, but in that, during the Drew McIntyre feud, the entire feud was basically Drew going, you're just a comedy guy. You don't deserve to be a big star. And Grado was amazing when he was trying to be serious. And he was pulling from that Dusty Rhodes, I'm just like everyone else in the crowd. We all deserve this. He was so good.
Right, so the whole feud was built. So it's kind of like a flip of the Ospreay Jimmy Havoc one, where it's like, you're just a deathmatch wrestler. This was, you're just a comedy wrestler. And yeah, they did exactly a similar kind of, I'm going to have to check it out then, because I haven't seen that, to be fair. So,
yeah, it borrowed elements from Flair, Dusty Rhodes. I loved it so much. Grado should be a megastar. He's not even on, he's barely on TNA these days. It's a crying yeah, shame. And I think TNA killed him more than
he's played a very, very important role. He's playing at the moment a very important role in Impact, because he's introducing the world to Joe Hendry. Yeah, not a Joe Hendry fan?
Joe Hendry. God, I swear we're going to talk about Wembley at some point. I swear.
Well, I'll let you quickly go off about Joe Hendry, and then we'll get on with the show.
Yeah, I know we're short on time as well, but Joe Hendry is a very charismatic guy. His in-ring isn't quite there yet, and I wish he wasn't getting pushed in places like Impact before his in-ring was.
Man, I love Joe Hendry.
That's my short.
I love Joe Hendry. He entertains the shit out of me, and that's what matters to me. Is you know, are you not entertained? Yes, I'm very much entertained by Joe Hendry. So
he's super entertaining, but if the in-ring's not there, there's a ceiling to how entertaining he can be and how long it can last.
Fair enough.
And he's a guy who I think he has a higher ceiling. He's just going at it too early. Anyway, Progress Wembley. I'm so sorry.
Progress Wembley. Yeah, let's have a look at Progress Wembley. You want to go through the entire card?
Yeah.
Same. Yeah. All right. We'll start with Mark Haskins and Matt Riddle. Matt Riddle's last independent wrestling match, which, as you said, can we really call it independent? We could probably do a whole show about that, but it's his last match not in WWE proper.
Yes, and Matt Riddle is... If Evolve is Matt Riddle's home promotion, then Progress is his home away from home. He showed up at a show 2 years ago, became the biggest star in the company, basically, in that one show.
Yeah.
And he had a long run as the Atlas Division champion. And the gimmick there is it's a title for people over 205. This is a really... There's no story behind this match, really, beyond just, hey, it's Matt Riddle.
yeah, that's it. Well, it's also Mark Haskins, who I'm a big fan of. Mark Haskins, I enjoy Mark.
Yeah, Mark Haskins is great. Is it Riddle and Haskins? I think have only had one match against each other. One match I can think of, in OTT, which was amazing. So this is going to be a great match. But this entire card is very story heavy, and there's not much story for this one, particularly beyond.
Right.
It's a great match.
Do we think it'll open?
I don't think it's going to open. I reckon the tag team match or the women's match is going to end up opening. I imagine this somewhere in the middle of the card. It'll be great.
It'll be a good send-off. Yeah. Good send-off.
Progress does send-offs really, really well for people outside to WWE, so this will be a joy.
Yeah. And then you touched on the tag team there, the tag team Thunderbastard. For those who are unaware, what is the tag team Thunderbastard?
Right, so the Thunderbastard is Progress's it's their attempt at the Royal Rumble. It's closer to Aztec Warfare, which Lucha Underground does.
Yes.
People come in after a certain amount of time, pinfalls and submissions. There's no over-the-top rope throwing, it's just pinfalls and submissions. They normally do one of these a year. This year, they've done their annual one in February. They did one over WrestleMania weekend. And they're doing a tag team version at Wembley. Now, there's a lot to talk about, annoyingly, with this tag team Thunderbastard, because, first of all, it's for the titles.
Yes. Which are currently on Flamita and Bandido.
Flamita and Bandido, yes. They won it during the Coast to Coast tour. Now, with the Thunderbastard, along with the Thunderbastard, they had a Tag Team Thunderbastard series, where all of the people involved in it, in the match, are put into this league, and whoever ends up being top of the league will come out last during the Thunderbuster. So,
okay,
a very cool idea. The issue is, I can tell you with 100% certainty, there's only two people in the world that actually know the standings of the series. The issue, right. One of the issues Progress has is they're not very good at. They really like doing long-term tournaments, but they're not very good at them. What ends up happening is, halfway through, they just sort of get bored and start doing something else and just let it.
They just lose interest.
Yeah, they lose interest. They just let it go on in the background, and like people don't care.
Right.
They've had a couple long-term tournaments this year, which have all had the same issue. Starts off really, really cool, then just dwindles away, and then no one cares. This tournament specifically has had a couple of issues as well. One of the teams was originally Flash Morgan Webster and Mark Haskins. Because Zack Sabre Jr. and Will Ospreay ended up getting pulled from this show, they needed someone to. They had to take Mark Haskins out of this. It's so complicated. They had to take Mark Haskins out of this tournament so that he could be a part of the 3-and-in tournament.
Oh, the 3-and-in, right. So, yeah. The 3-and-in which
Tyler Bate won, which was for the number one contendership. That's the shoot reason. The kayfabe explanation they gave is that when the contract... listen to how carefully I'm trying to get this all across, because it's so complicated. The contracts the teams had to sign to be a part of the tag team series had a spot to put in the team name, right?
Yeah.
Flash Morgan Webster and Mark Haskins didn't have a team name, so they didn't put anything in that spot. But Flash Morgan Webster did. He put in the 198, which is the name of his tag team with the Wild Boar. So
they had to take Haskins out and put Boar in.
Yes, because they got all of their points because contract law, apparently.
Yeah. Which is exactly what you want in your punk rock pro wrestling.
Of course, I want...
is a storyline about contract law.
Yeah. Something... there's been more issues. Yes, the other issue with this series has been... and this is no one's fault, but Chris Brooks, he was originally teaming with Kid Lykos in this series. Kid Lykos obviously got injured, and so during the Coast to Coast tour, because this is the other thing, in the tag team series, the title is always on the line in the series matches. So whoever's the champion, they're defending the title as well as being a part of this series. So CCK, Chris Brooks and Kid Lykos ended up winning the tag titles. Lykos got injured. Brooks defended the title with Gresham a couple times. Ended up losing them while teaming with AR Fox.
Yes.
Because for some reason AR Fox was a part of that team. Brooks is now teaming with Thatcher in this actual Thunderbastard. No real explanation why, he just is. And Flamita and Mandy.
So it's a bit of a cluster.
Yeah, and Flamita and Bandido weren't actually a part of the tag team series, but they had a title shot anyway, and they won the titles anyway, and they're now a part of the series anyway, and they're opening anyway. They're the first entrants in the tournament,
right?
And the Thunderbuster, because. Yeah. Can you tell I don't like
that? That makes perfect sense. Yeah, yeah. I think it'll still be exciting.
It'll be great.
Watch,
it'll be a really, really fun match, but following...
But it's a bit of a mess. A bit of a mess going in.
Some of it's not their fault. Some of it is.
Yeah. Yeah. And then we have the Progress women's title. Now, this one, Ginny, Toni Storm, and Millie McKenzie.
Yeah. So, Toni Storm was the inaugural women's champion. She ended up losing the title to Ginny. They have a long, long history with each other. Ginny has the House of Couture behind her, which is a stable of Charlie Morgan, Nina Samuels, Chikara. Yeah, those three.
Chikara, I like Chikara. She's impressive.
Chikara's really good. I really like Charlie Morgan.
Charlie Morgan. I'm familiar with Charlie Morgan from Eve as well, and so I like all these girls, to be honest with you. But Chikara was someone who recently I've been getting more up to date on Progress, and Chikara impresses me a lot.
Yeah, she's all four of the House of Couture are actually really, really good.
It's a bit of an OP stable.
Yeah, they've been teasing that Charlie Morgan is more interested in the title than she is helping Ginny, so there might be a turn there.
Right.
Story coming into this was Ginny and Toni Storm was the match originally. Toni Storm got injured. They had this number one contenders match, which Millie won, but the match got made into a three-way because, again, I don't know what the kayfabe explanation was, but the real explanation is just Toni Storm's supposed to be in this match, so it's a three-way now. I suppose just because Ginny and Toni Storm have a lot of history.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, it's a little unsatisfying, but the match itself, once again, all these matches look really good on paper, so the match itself should be...
The card on paper looks amazing.
I'm looking for Millie McKenzie to win this
one. Hope so.
I'm looking at... Yeah.
Because Millie is only a couple of years into her career right now, and she's amazingly good. She's one of these wrestlers who's like 18, 19 years old and wrestles like she's been wrestling for about 20 years, which happens a lot in the
scene. Yeah, I was going to say, it happens a lot in Japan.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, to see that over there. Millie McKenzie's very good, and I'm definitely looking forward to seeing more of her. I imagine it won't be long before she's snapped up into WWE system.
I think she might be in it already.
There you go. I didn't know. I haven't. Yeah.
Or at the very least is very, very much on their radar. Again, I don't want to say too much because it involves spoilers.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I definitely think she's got to be on the radar.
Yeah.
And then after that match, we have listed here Doug Williams, Trent Seven. This one's for the Atlas Championship, which you mentioned just previously, for those above 205. Doug Williams, Trent Seven, holy crap.
Yeah.
The grappling that will be had in this match.
It's going to be great. I'm a little bit disappointed just because, the angle coming into this is that Doug Williams doesn't feel like he's on the same level as the rest of the talent. So he said a while ago, look, the next match I lose, that's my last match, I'm going, I'm done. It's the old Ric Flair story.
Right.
But in that time, the Atlas title was vacated and Doug Williams happened to win the match where the Atlas title was on the line. And
so
he's been defending that title for a while.
With the caveat that when he loses,
he's done.
Most
people assume, look, it's Wembley. If you're going to retire Doug Williams, Wembley's the place to do it.
Yeah, this looks like another farewell match.
Yeah. Progress guys love Doug Williams, and I mean everyone loves Doug Williams. Everyone appreciates what Doug Williams has done. Because Johnny and Jody were a big deal to the scene, but Doug was. I would say Doug is bigger just because he was also on Impact. He made more of a mark than Johnny and Jody did. They're all three are super important, but I think Doug just edges out.
But Magnus isn't important.
I don't get me started on Magnus. I have so many opinions on Magnus.
No, we don't. We really don't have time. But Trent Seven's the one that you want to do the honor here. If it is his last match.
Yeah, I would have liked it to been someone a little bit younger, because Trent Seven is very much established now. But I don't have any real qualms with it. One of the interesting wrinkles of this whole story is that even though Trent Seven's only really coming out now, he's not that much older than Doug Williams. He's of the same generation, really. So one of the ideas of this story is Trent Seven wanting to prove that he could hang with the people of the past, and it's not just lucky that he's come along now. It'll be a fun match.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Now, the Eddie Dennis Mark Andrews match.
Yes.
This is a TLC match. Now, I'm going to need you to run me through the story on this one quickly, because I got confused.
Okay, so Eddie Dennis and Mark Andrews were a tag team, FSU. Eddie Dennis became a full-time wrestler about a year ago now. He used to be a headmaster at a school, but because...
Right, yeah, so I saw that. So he quit his job to pursue this full-time.
Yeah, and it was a very, very big deal at the time, because obviously it's a real good full-time job. It's not like, some little thing a lot of wrestlers do. It's a proper job. He quit to pursue wrestling full-time because all of his contemporaries were becoming these huge stars. And then he ended up turning heel on Mark Andrews. Because he felt like Mark was holding him back. And there's a really interesting story on, look, I've got a mortgage to pay. I can't be losing these matches and all of this. I need to be being a big star. Unfortunately, Eddie Dennis got injured during this time.
That's going to derail
it. It was really depressing because it was within the first couple of months of him going full time. And obviously, if he had a normal job, he would not be in as bad a situation as he was. So they kept this angle going with the idea that Eddie Dennis now just despises Mark Andrews and wants to end Mark Andrews. It was done...
His promo at Chapter 75, where he's like listing all the people that Mark Andrews uses, and he's talking about, you used your parents for free rent, you used Pete to get over in WWE, you used pro wrestling to get your shitty band over. It was a fire promo. Yeah. Like, I really enjoyed it.
So he's been cutting promos like that for about 6 months. He's been so honestly, he's carried this entire feud of just a couple amazing promos. And because the angle is really, it's really interesting, because obviously there's some truth to it. He is a man that's had to, he's quit his job and he's decided to pursue wrestling. And you can respect that, but also he's been a bit of a dick about it. There's shades of grey. As a quick aside, he's now signed with WWE UK, so everything's fine. He's fine. He's done well.
Yeah, so it's coming along nicely. And this one comes to a head in a TLC match at Wembley, which is going to be huge. Mark Andrews in a TLC match is definitely worth watching. And for the record, his band's not that shitty, okay?
His band is fine.
I'm a pop punk kid, so I like Junior. Moving along, Jimmy Havoc. Paul Robinson. So Paul Robinson at 75, he gave Jimmy Havoc the stomp onto the tacks.
Yeah, so this match has a lot of history behind it.
Yeah, right. So it ties into the whole Jimmy Havoc Will Ospreay story, I believe, as well.
So basically, Will Ospreay, Paul Robinson, I'm going to try and keep this short because we're running low on time.
Yes. I have other things to get to in my life. I do apologize, but we'll try to get through the rest of the card.
Paul Robinson and Jimmy Havoc. Sorry, Paul Robinson and Will Ospreay were a tag team called the Swords of Essex.
Yes.
During the Jimmy Havoc main big angle, Paul Robinson turned on Will Ospreay to join up with Jimmy Havoc. After Will Ospreay finally won the title off of Jimmy Havoc, Paul Robinson beat Jimmy Havoc in a death match, which was Jimmy Havoc's last match in progress for quite a while. So this match was originally supposed to be Jimmy Havoc versus Will Ospreay, but obviously Ospreay got pulled for FSU, the New Japan show, not the tag team. And so they pivoted this to Paul Robinson. Another wrinkle in this match is that Paul Robinson had to retire early last year, I want to say, because he had, I don't know the exact details, but there was just some genetic disorder which meant he couldn't wrestle at a high level full time. He was working as an agent at Progress for a while. But he found out recently that he can wrestle full time again. So this is not only is this a match with a lot of history, but it's also Paul Robinson's first match back in Progress for over a year.
Right, as an active competitor, yeah.
As an active competitor, yes. It's going to be crazy. These guys had an insane death match in early
Progress. Is there a stipulation on this match, though?
It's no DQ, I think.
Okay, I didn't see that. So yeah, so if it's no DQ, then yeah, that's definitely one to get excited about.
Look, you're not playing these two in a match, in a normal match.
No, that's what I thought. I thought it was strange that the site that I got the card off didn't say it was no DQ, but saying that it's no DQ puts me much more at ease and also makes me much more uncomfortable about watching it. But that's another story. Pete Dunne, Ilya Dragunov, the build for this one has been very enjoyable. They've been building it for a while. Christian Michael Jacoby, am I saying that right? Jacoby?
Yeah. Jacoby.
Jacoby, okay, there we go. Yeah, he's the promoter for WXW.
Yeah, so the basic story of this is...
he's calling out Pete Dunne, right?
Yeah, basically he's just going, Pete Dunne, you think you're the best in the world, in Europe. You're not the best in Europe. Ilya Dragunov, a dude who is incredible and is probably the best in Europe, is the best in Europe.
Yeah, but he called Pete Dunne an overrated backyarder. I mean, come on, man. This is Pete fucking Dunne, you know?
Yeah, no, that's fair. He is a former backyarder, whatever.
but he's overrated, I actually consider Pete Dunne to be underrated. Like, why he's not already WWE champion, I don't understand.
Because he's a little man.
He's tiny.
He's short.
But he doesn't come across as tiny, you know, and that's what matters. Yeah. That's what matters. Anyway, so he puts forth Ilya Dragunov as the proof. He puts forth Ilya Dragunov as the proving point that Pete Dunne's not even the best in Europe.
Yeah, exactly. So the basic story is just that, and Christian Michael Jacoby is playing this almost like foreign invader to Progress.
It's brilliant. It's a brilliant shtick. I really enjoy it.
Yeah, this match is going to be absolutely incredible. There's no denying that. Ilya Dragunov, I think he's not quite known yet. He had that Bola.
He just had a big weekend at Bola, where the people that I spoke to said that he was one of the most impressive of the weekend. A lot of people went in not having a clue who he was and came out raving about him. So
yeah, whenever Bola ends up dropping, I think a lot of people are going to realize this guy is a big, big deal.
When the DVDs drop, for sure.
Yeah, the reason he didn't ever really become a big deal is he was also working a full-time job, which meant it was difficult for him to wrestle outside of Germany, basically.
Right.
Progress themselves haven't done a ton to build this match up beyond just a couple promos. WXW have helped a little bit. So Ilya Dragunov has a very famous rivalry with Volta, and Pete Dunne had a match with Volta at WXW, which I recommend everyone check out. to sort of help build up this match.
Yeah, because then he called out Ilya and they had a big brawl.
Yeah, it was great. This match will be great. Watch this match.
Yeah, I think it's one of the best built matches of the year, to be honest with you. Like, even though they haven't done much, as you said, what they've done has been super effective.
Yeah, and I suppose you don't need to do a ton, really.
No, not at all. I mean, look at like what was one of the other best built matches of the year, Aldis and Cody, right? And they didn't touch, you know?
Yeah,
you can say what you want about the actual match, but the build was incredible. And this is similar. This has a really, really strong build where I'm very excited for this match. And then the main event, we talked about it before. Tyler Bate won the number one contendership by winning the 3 and in tournament. So now he goes up against Volta for the Progress title. I'm calling Mustache Mountain are walking out of here with all the gold. And I'm including Millie McKenzie in that.
I think it's very likely. So there's a lot of interesting stuff about this match. It was originally supposed to be a Zack Sabre Jr. match because he won Super Strong Style, which is Progress's annual tournament.
But then he had to get pulled out. Why did he have to get pulled out?
Because the New Japan show, FSU. He's working FSU as well.
Right, yeah, the fighting, yep, okay, Fighting Spirit Unleashed, yeah. Same, yeah. Because it's on the same day, yeah.
Yeah, it is. That's just...
Which is an extension of the thing that I ranted about this morning on my podcast for Aussie Graps. Stop running shows on the same day. I mean, this is an international thing, it's an entirely different ballpark, but it's disappointing.
This is just really, really unlucky because the way New Japan releases their schedule is they do it every 6-month blocks to the wrestlers.
Yeah.
And so no one had any idea the show was even happening.
Yeah, it's unfortunate.
Yeah, Zack Sabre Jr. ended up winning the Super Strong Style, but it's very, very obvious that Tyler Bate was supposed to win Super Strong Style, but he ended up getting injured in a match against Cassius Ohno, Chris Hero.
Yes, yeah.
So it's cool that Tyler Bate, even though he didn't end up winning Super Strong Style, has still ended up the main event of Wembley. Tyler Bate in Progress hasn't been very good for a while, just because he's relying a lot on shtick. He's doing a sort of weird Conor McGregor-style gimmick.
Yeah, where he's enjoying all the success that he's had, and he's splashing out, and he's buying chains.
Exactly.
And being like a cocky asshole like Conor McGregor.
Yeah, calling himself the big strong boy, which I hate so much. So much.
I love it. I love big strong boy.
Anything. What does it mean?
He's a big strong boy.
Yeah, and when
have you seen how much he can deadlift?
Yeah, and when he's cutting these promos and being like, I'm not a boy anymore, I'm a man. Or yeah, I'm the big strong boy. That doesn't sound, you know. I'm not intimidated by a man that's calling himself the big strong boy.
The big strong boy. It's maybe that's the point, right? It's to get in your heads, to mislead you. Like, he's just a boy, right?
Maybe.
This guy, they talk about it in one of the hype up videos that you sent me. He can deadlift 2 Walters.
Yeah, no, he's absurdly strong. It's like,
ridiculously strong. He does that spot with the, in NXT, he did that spot where he did the, the Cesaro swing. I guess I don't know the actual name of it, but the swing move while he has someone else in a fireman's carry.
Yeah.
Like, holy crap.
No, it's
the strength on this kid.
It's insane how strong he is. Walter has a very... The world title scene in Progress has a very interesting story recently. Travis Banks won the title at their big show last year. Progress don't know how to book face champions, unfortunately. And so the crowd started to turn on Travis Banks. So they turned him heel. It wasn't very good. Travis Banks is a guy who's one of the best in the world, and he was being really badly misused. Walter was the former Atlas champion. He gave up the title to try and pursue the world title, even though he'd already had a match for the world title while Atlas champion. Another thing Progress did, which I don't... It's really dumb. He finally won the world title. His Atlas run was incredible. His world title run, I haven't seen most of it yet, but from what I've heard, has been very, very good. Walter is my wrestler of the year right now. This match is going to be incredible. I think I've said it all.
Yeah, Volta is money. He's and WWE are very interested in Volta.
He's never
and,
gonna
and I can imagine.
He's never
no, and he's very openly said, I'm not interested at all in moving to America. I'm not interested in working, you know, maybe NXT, but not definitely not Raw or SmackDown, which I love hearing that, by the way.
Yeah.
I love hearing that. And he makes a living as it is, so he doesn't need to. He's doing it, he's doing the WXW dojo he runs over there. So, you know, and yeah, like you said, Wrestler of the Year, there's definitely a case to be made.
Yeah, he's never going to sign. He's more interested in trying to work Japan, which he has.
Right, and that's why the whole he's never going to sign thing, that's why I think that Tyler Bate wins. I think that's one of the reasons, too, because, you know, Progress are in WWE's pocket. So I think that, you know, Tyler Bate's going to be the champion walking out of Wembley.
Yeah, I'm against that just because I think we've just come off of Tyler Bate and Trent Seven being tag champs for ages. And
yeah,
I think if you put the title on one of British Strong Style, any title on one of British Strong Style, there's a real ceiling to what you can do, because even though, yeah, you're in bed with WWE, you know, and the crowd knows, at some point this man is going to leave, and you don't want to put too many eggs in that basket, and you don't want to get fully invested, yeah, because you know, okay, yeah, he's having this great title run, but I might not see him in 3 months or 4 months or 5 months.
Yeah, no, that's fair. That's fair. But I'm still predicting it. That's my prediction.
Tyler walks out with the crowd. I can see it. I don't want it.
Fair enough. But that does it. That's the Progress. Hello, Wembley. Takes place on this Sunday, the 30th. Hopefully this episode will be out before then. I can't promise it, though, but this episode should be out before then, so people will have heard this going into the show. If not, I mean, you can listen to this and then watch the show on demand anyway, because we live in... It's 2018, people. We live in the future.
The on-demand, so. The on-demand probably isn't going to come out until a week afterwards, so even if the show has happened, this hopefully will be out before the show is released.
It will be. It will be out before the show is released on demand, definitely. But that does it for this month in BritRes for September. Where can people find you, Akhil, if they want to, you know, tell you that your opinions are shite?
You can follow me on Twitter at Akhil Khalid, AQELKHALID. As always, I'm open to have a chat about why you think I'm wrong. Adam Brooks is bad, I swear to God.
Don't do this to me.
You can edit that out if you want. Review.
No, I'll leave it. I'll leave it. It's fine. You want to get me in trouble. That's what you want to do. You want to get
it's
me in trouble.
My job.
ReviewReviews.com.
I help out with that site. We're just finishing Suzuki September, which is a project wherein we try to review a Minoru Suzuki match every day to just look at how crazy and weird his career has been. It's been a lot of fun. I'm just about to start the WDKW 2010s, which is a project wherein I try to rank the 100 best wrestlers of the 2010s. It's a fun little project. Follow along. It'll be great.
All right. And I am at Greg Unchained on Twitter, at the Greg Unchained on Instagram. We collectively are the B+ Wrestle on Twitter, because wrestling wouldn't fit. The B+ Wrestling everywhere else. Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, Spotify, Stitcher Radio, whatever it's called, all those places taking over the world. Leave us a 5-star review on iTunes. It really helps us out, helps us grow the show. Like, share, subscribe, and thank you so much for listening.
Hold one! I'm Greg!
You're not doing this. Get out. Let me tell you a personal story about Vince McMahon. Yeah. You just made the list!
Oh my God! Sorry, no speaking wish.
Dummy!
The worst town I've ever been in.
It's still real to me, damn it.
Coming. Yeah.
Hold three. The moss covered. Three handle family.